Well, it happened back in 1982. Some of you may remember it. Others of you may not because you weren't born yet. But Larry Walters was actually interviewed on David Letterman. If you're unfamiliar with the story or you doubt whether or not to believe me, you can always check this on YouTube and you'll be able to see an interview with David Letterman and Larry Walter. But Walter lived in North Hollywood outside of Los Angeles, and he would sit right there in his backyard in an aluminum lawn chair, and he would dream of doing something one day that he had never been able to do, and that was to fly. He saw planes fly overhead all the time, but he knew he would never be able to get up in one of those. So you know what he did? One day he decided to make his dream a reality. And he got 43 weather balloons. He got some helium tanks. He got peanut butter and jelly sandwiches, a BB gun, a CB radio, and also a six-pack of beer. You knew alcohol had to be involved in this somehow, right? And he decided to set launch and to set sail upward in order to just see what it was like to float above his subdivision. He thought, this will be kind of funny. I'll attach the balloons to my aluminum lawn chair, and after I float it up a couple hundred feet, you know, my neighbors will say, oh boy, there's lawn chair Larry. That guy is crazy, and they'll all laugh, and then I'll take my BB gun, I'll shoot down some of these things, and I'll slowly come back down. Everything went fine until when he took off and they untethered him. He went up about 1,000 feet a minute, and at 16,000 feet, he found himself right in the middle of the LAX approach corridor. As you can imagine, this was a little disconcerting. There was a Delta flight that saw him. There was a TWA flight that also confirmed his altitude at that time. He is gingerly and slowly shooting the balloons down one at a time, he said, from the outside in. Of course, the media got involved, the LAPD got involved, everybody did. They're trying to follow him and see where it is that he is going to come down. There's a picture of him there that you can see, and it looks kind of archaic, but he said, I felt safe the whole time I was up there. Well, when he did finally come down, the media got to him before the police did. And so they had an impromptu press conference right there with Larry Walter. They thrust microphones in his face, and they said to this very quiet and docile man, they said, were you scared? He said, yes, at times I was. He said, would you do it again? He said, no, I would not. And then they asked him this great question. They said, Larry, why in the world did you do it in the first place? Why in the world did you do it in the first place? You know what he said? Well, you just can't sit there. That was his response. You just can't sit in your backyard in your aluminum lawn chair. I mean, there's some days where you just have to get involved and you have to do something. That's my kind of guy. There comes a point where you have to take a risk. You have to do something and get out of your comfort zone. We talked last week about having a responsive faith, which is willing to give what the Lord requests of us. And today we want to continue to cultivate that concept of an active faith, of getting involved, of becoming a bold participant rather than an apathetic spectator. And that becomes easier for us to do if you have a respect for the person or you have a belief in the cause that requests your involvement. In fact, the more you respect your boss or your resident assistant or your spiritual leaders, the more apt you are to just not sit there. Think of it like this. I put this on your note page. Every organization needs people whose respect for the leader causes them to take bold steps of faith. You got to have it. I want to invite you to take your Bible out, if you would, and I want you to turn to the 10th book of the Bible. It's 2 Samuel. 2 Samuel chapter 23. I'd love to hear those pages turning. 2 Samuel chapter 23. In the Old Testament, we read an awful lot about a guy named David. He was revered by the Jewish people and was probably the greatest king of all times in the Jewish people's minds. But today, we will discover that there were some unsung heroes whose respectful faith and devotion to their leader allowed David to become a better leader than he would have been without them. They were a subset of a larger group, but they were known as David's three mighty men. And we pick up the story in 2 Samuel chapter 23, and we begin with verse 8, where we see the first mighty men. These are the names of the mighty men whom David had: Jashib, Bashibeth, a Tachimamite. He was the chief of the three. He wielded his spear against 800 whom he killed at one time. So let's stop right there. Jashib, Bashibeth, the Kenanite, the Tachimanite, is the very first person that we want to write down. If you come to every service this weekend, you will hear me say their names differently every single time. All right? I've tried really hard, but I can't do any better. Now, this gentleman, it sounds gruesome, but this gentleman killed 800 people. No wonder he is listed first. You say, well, that's not humanly possible in one encounter for a person just to go on, and his life not to be taken, but 800 others to be taken. You're right, it's probably not humanly possible. But these people were enemies of the Lord. We'll talk a little bit more later about how this could have happened. Look at the next verse in verses 9 and 10. We'll see the second mighty man. And next to him among the three mighty men was Eleazar, the son of Dodo, the son of Ahohai. He was with David when they defied the Philistines who were gathered there for battle, and the men of Israel withdrew. He rose and struck down the Philistines until his hand was weary and his hand clung to the sword. And the Lord brought about a great victory that day, and the men returned after him only to strip the slain. So this is the second of David's three mighty men. So write this down: Eleazar, the son of Dodo. So for obvious reasons, he grew up to be a fighter, right? You know, I mean, it makes sense if you think about it. If the guy's dad's name was Dodo, can you imagine the taunting that he received on the playground growing up? No wonder he pursued a career as a warrior. I'm from Louisville, Kentucky, and we have champion boxer and world-renowned Muhammad Ali is from Louisville. He passed away 2 years ago, and you may not know one of the most retold stories in my neck of the woods that people always talk about with Muhammad Ali is the true account of how it is that he got into boxing. And when Ali was a child, his parents gave him as a gift, they gave him a brand new bicycle, and he loved that bicycle. But several days later, someone stole it from his backyard. And he was so mad, and a Louisville police officer asked him, said, "What are you going to do if you catch the boy who stole it?" And Muhammad Ali said, I don't know. I don't know what I'll do. And the police officer took him under his wing, and he took him down to a gym, and he began teaching Muhammad Ali how to box. And for decades, Muhammad Ali, in interviews, would say, to this day, he said, "I have never found my bike, but every time I get in the boxing ring, I look across at my opponent and I say, that's the guy who stole my bike." It worked out pretty well for him, right? Well, the Bible tells us that this Eleazar, the son of Dodo, fought so long one time that the sword, it actually became stuck to his hand. I don't know if it became kind of frozen in there, if in cold weather you've just held on to something for so long and you can't let go of it, just becomes part of who you are. That's what happened on that day. He fought for so long. Look at your next verse, verse 11, and we're going to see the third member of these mighty men. And next to him was Shema, the son of Agi, the Hararite. The Philistines gathered together at Lehi, where there was a plot of ground full of lentils, and the men fled from the Philistines. But he took a stand in the midst of the plot and defended it and struck down the Philistines, and the Lord worked a great victory. So this is the third of the three mighty men, Shema, the son of Agi. Shema, who stationed himself out in the middle of a field, and when all of his comrades abandoned him, he fought the Philistines all by himself, and he defeated them. These are incredible stories, and I don't want to just gloss over them because the Old Testament is filled with stories of passion and heroism, but most all of them pale in comparison to the passion of David's mighty 30 men. There were 30 men that are talked about. These are the three who excel out of those 30. And it's interesting because in the Old Testament here, it lists 37 different names for us. So we don't know if, as a person would die from the rough job that they had, that they would replace that person and then they would continue to put them in the list. Maybe that's how they got at 37. Or maybe where the Bible says there were 30 men, it was more of a round number than a specific number. Nevertheless, there were three who excelled in this group. They were loyal warriors to King David. None of them were content to just sit in their backyard. But I want you to look at the preceding paragraph because it recounts all these mighty men have done, but there's more to the story. Someone else is involved and in on the play. Look at verse 10 with Eleazar. It says, "And the Lord brought about a great victory that day." Look at verse 12 with Shema. I made this a fill in the blank on your outline page. "And the Lord worked a great victory." That is so significant. There's more than just a respect for David's leadership. These three evidently have a respectful faith in the one who does the supernatural. And he is ultimately responsible for these victories. And this section being included in the scripture is an expression by David that he recognized that his life is not just all wrapped up in me and God. It's not just God and me and me and God. No, it goes far beyond that. God's best work through us is always done in community. David's mighty men have been with him through everything, through every high, through every low. And you need some other people in your life as well. And that's why you hear us encouraging you all the time to get involved in a small group. Pour into others. Let others pour into you. The Bible says in Proverbs, as iron sharpens iron. This is a way that you can grow spiritually and relationally. You can learn God's word and you can learn how it is that you can apply what was written thousands of years ago into your very own life today. And with the fall approaching, I'm just saying now is a great time to pursue this. My wife and I, we've been involved in a small group for decades, different ones at different times, different seasons of our life. But I mean, it has breathed life into us. And to have people that we feel like have our back. And have people who, when they go through a difficult time, we've got their back. There's just something that happens when brothers and sisters bind together. And if you have an interest in finding out more about that, at the info counter at every campus, you can go there after the service and you can find out what it would look like for you to take that next step so that you could get connected in a small group. There's a Kenyan proverb that says it like this. It says, if you want to go fast, then go alone. But if you want to go far, then take some others with you. I'd encourage you to take some others with you. King David believed in that. The setting in 2 Samuel 23 is that David is in a conflict with the Philistines. He remembers a cave where years before he sought refuge from King Saul. So like a child who goes back to his best hide-and-seek spot, David retreats to this cave, this harbor, this haven where he could hide from the Philistines. It's called the Cave of Adullam. And that's where he just kind of hangs out. That's his spot. That's his Camp David. It's in the middle of a cave. And the Philistines had attacked the southern part of Judah. Some of the Philistines had attacked and even taken over the city of Bethlehem. And now they're living inside of the city of Bethlehem. Bethlehem was David's hometown. Think back, if you had that big role in the Christmas play, you remember that? You were the angel, and they stuck you up there, and you had one line you had to say. You remember that line? It was very simple. For unto you is born this day in the city of... Why they call it the city of David? The angel said that because that's how it was known. It was David's city. Bethlehem was David's hometown. If you drove your car to Louisville, Kentucky today, as you drive into Louisville, you would see a massive building that had Muhammad Ali's picture on the side of it. And it would say, Muhammad's Louisville. Okay? You would have driven into Bethlehem back years ago. They would have had all sorts of things all about David Because for centuries he continues to be revered as the king. This is David's hometown. That's why the angel referred to Bethlehem as David's city hundreds of years later. So here's what I want us to do today. I want us to discover that there are three lessons from this story that you can very easily apply to your own life. Lesson number one, God unifies us through our weaknesses and not our strengths. That's what he's going to do with this group of men. God's going to unify them through their weaknesses, not their strengths. Now, these men who banded together with David, they go all the way back, not just to 2 Samuel, but they go all the way back to 1 Samuel. They go back to 1 Samuel chapter 22, which is years before our text today. It's a time when David is on the run from King Saul. Saul is trying to kill him. David has been named that he's going to be the next king. Let's just say the transition is not going real smoothly, right? And King Saul is trying to kill David. But David has some morals and some principles. And even though he has the opportunity to kill the king, the Lord's anointed, he won't do it. And even when given this opportunity, David won't fight back. Instead, he retreats into the cave of Adullam for safety's sake. And that becomes his harbor. But this passage gives us a glimpse into David's leadership and his charisma. Listen to 1 Samuel chapter 22, verses 1 and 2. David departed from there and escaped to the cave of Adullam. And when his brothers and all his father's house heard it, they went down there to him. And everyone who was in distress and everyone who was in debt and everyone who was bitter in soul gathered to him. And he became commander over them. And there were about 400 men. Now, years later in our text, David decides to go back to the cave of Adullam. And later we'll read that this cave is actually a stronghold for David. You say, well, what does that mean, that it's a stronghold for David? Sometimes we hear the term stronghold and we think of it in a negative sense. We think it's used when a person talks about, well, I've got some bad habits in my life and they've kind of got a stronghold on me. And we see it as something that's rather negative. It's something that we're trying to overcome, that Satan is besetting us in some way. And while that's an accurate use of the term, in this particular context, the word stronghold is describing a place of refuge. It's a shelter from the enemy, a space to recover and rest from the battle. Earlier, I called it a haven. And David desperately needed that. He needed a refuge. And it turns out the other people did too. Back in 1 Samuel in chapter 22, years before, it says that these men who came there, did you catch this? It said they were distressed. It says they were discontent. It says they were in debt. And I want to point out something that I don't want to go unnoticed, that these men came to David by choice. There was no draft that said, he's going to be the next king, so you need to all say that you're going to follow him. No, they just followed him because of his charisma and his leadership. After all, remember what he had done as a teen. He had killed Goliath, the leader of the Philistines. And so they saw some incredible faith in this young man of God. And they said, man alive, he's got a totally different attitude. Everybody else looked at Goliath and said, man, he's so big, we'll never get him. And David's attitude was, he's so big, how can I miss? David's attitude was one that said, I don't care how big he is, my God is much bigger than any giant. And so these men were attracted to him, and they wanted to follow him. And when David entered the cave, when every single one of those mighty men entered the cave, what they were doing is they were being vulnerable. They didn't act like they had it all together. They chose to receive the refuge that God had placed before them, and they physically stepped into that place. And just the fact that the Bible tells us the struggles that these men had tells us that they were honest with one another. Write this down on your sheet. You can't have a courageous faith without first going to the cave. You can't have a courageous faith without first going to the cave. They found community in spite of their weaknesses. And that's a picture of the church. That's what the church is supposed to be. It's not a perfect place. The leaders are not perfect. The members are not perfect. We come together as a colossal collection of people who are struggling, but we all look to the one who is perfect. He's our king. We will do whatever we can to please the king. The only difference between a Christian and a non-Christian is one is forgiven and one is not. Doesn't make you better than someone who's not a Christian. In God's eyes, he loves you equally. What it means is you're choosing, you're making that choice to say, Lord, I am vulnerable, I am weak. I need other Christians in my life. I need you. And so I would suggest to you that David had the cave of Adullam. That was his refuge. God was his refuge. I would challenge you to make your church your refuge. I would challenge you to make God's people your refuge. Psalm 62, listen to this, verse 5. For God alone, O my soul, wait in silence, for my hope is from him. He only is my rock and my salvation, my fortress. I shall not be shaken. On God rests my salvation and my glory. My mighty rock, my refuge is God. Trust in him at all times, O people. Pour out your heart before him. God is a refuge for us. When was the last time you saw God as a refuge for you? Here's the second lesson that I want us to discover, and that is vulnerability deepens the connection between the leader and the team. That happens when we're vulnerable. It doesn't happen when we act like we have our act together. It happens when we're honest and we're forthright and we share with people saying, hey, I could use some prayer. Look back at our main text in 2 Samuel chapter 23. There's this ongoing tension between the Israelites and the Philistines, who are the enemies of God, who mocked God. Look at verses 13 and 14, because this is where we re-pick up the story. And three of the 30 chief men went down and came about harvest time to David at the cave of Adullam, when a band of Philistines was encamped in the valley of Rephaim. David was then in the stronghold, there's that word, and the garrison of the Philistines was then at Bethlehem. So he is there, David is, with his close friends. He's hanging out in this cave, and he's there where there's no filter. He's there with people who he respects and who respect him. They know each other better than anyone else. There is openness, there is trust in that setting. And so when you're in a setting like that, what happens? You say what's on your heart. And that's exactly what David does in the security of the stronghold. He just thinks out loud. He verbalizes what's on his mind. Look at verse 15 of 2 Samuel 13. This is what David just said. He says one phrase. And David said longingly, oh, that someone would give me water to drink from the well of Bethlehem that is by the gate. So he's probably parched. I want to make certain that you've got this scene in your mind. David and his mighty men are holed up. They're hiding in this cave outside of Jerusalem. People are trying to find them and kill the king. About 6 miles away, Bethlehem is filled and surrounded with the enemies of God, the Philistines. And while in the cave, David just mumbles something. He just says, you know, he said, I'm dying to have a drink of water from my hometown well over there in Bethlehem, right there by the gate. So there must have been more than one well, and so he even goes to the trouble of specifying which one was his favorite well growing up and where he used to always run and get water. He said, I'd give anything just to have a drink of water from that town well. You know, we all have our cravings. Maybe for you it's sweet tea. Maybe it's your grandma's sweet tea. And when I say your grandma's sweet tea, you know, she just put her finger in that stuff and it would be as sweet as could be. And you can just taste it in your mouth just as I'm talking about, right? Dave Learned here from Rolling Meadows campus, I asked him, I said, what's your favorite drink from your childhood? He said, oh, that's so easy. He said, I grew up in Peoria, Illinois, and he had this, they said they had these ice cream places called Emo's. And he said, I would go down there and I would get a chocolate milkshake. How many of y'all have ever heard of Emo's? Okay, we've got a few. Well, Dave Learned would be very excited to meet you, all right? But there are all sorts of places. Now, my wife, her favorite drink is a McDonald's Coke. Is there anybody else that likes McDonald's Cokes? Yeah, boy, they're proud. It's like a cult, okay? I'll say, babe, we can get you, they sell Coke products right here. I'll get you a Coke right here. Oh, no. It's not the same. Evidently, Ronald is putting something in that Coke, okay? And one day when we get to heaven, we'll find out what it was, right? But that's what my wife, if I could just have a McDonald's Coke. And I understand the cravings of David after living with my wife, because if I could just have a drink of water from the town well at Bethlehem, and his three mighty men overhear this campfire comment, and I can just picture this happening. They get their heads together. David's looking the other way, and one says, hey, are you thinking what I'm thinking? Oh, yeah, we're already ahead of you. It's about 6 miles, maybe 7 miles at the most from here. I think we can do it. You want to go for it? Yeah, let's do it. What have we got to lose? Your life. The well is totally surrounded by Philistines. Bethlehem is totally surrounded by Philistines. They're camped out there. But these three mighty men, who we've already read of their exploits, they band together and they take off on this journey, and David doesn't know that it's even happening. He has no idea. And this leads us with this passionate purpose, this spontaneous, unplanned mission of mercy for their master. This leads us to the third lesson to write down. Lesson number three, love and loyalty propel them to risk their lives to please the king. They will do anything to please the king. This is going the extra mile and then some on this dangerous trip. We pick it up. Look in your Bible at verse 16. Then the three mighty men broke through the camp of the Philistines, drew water out of the well of Bethlehem that was by the gate, and carried and brought it back to David. That phrase, broke through the camp of the Philistines. You know, this is not just a subtle little sliding through a secret passageway. I mean, they had to get physical. They broke through the camp. Their presence didn't go unnoticed. Swords are flying. Can you imagine them drawing the water? Two guys guarding while one guy's drawing the water. Let's go for it. They're trying to pour it into a canteen or wineskins. Go, go, go. And they're trying to run with it. They want to make certain they've got some water that they can bring back to the king. They come running all the way back. They have to make certain that no enemy follows them to find out where David's stronghold is. And they return to the cave, and as they walk in, they probably announce, special delivery for King David. And David is oblivious to what's been going on until maybe somebody lights a torch. And they bring this torch out, and now all of a sudden he sees his three mighty men, bumps and bruises, sweaty and bloody, fresh wounds. They are exhausted, yet they are smiling. And then one of them reaches back behind his back and he pulls out the water and he bows down before the king and he lifts it up to him. He says, drink it. He says, drink every last drop of it. I think you're going to enjoy it. In fact, my Lord, when you take the first drink, you're going to know exactly where it's from. And it's in that moment that David begins to understand the level of loyalty of his followers. And it begins to dawn on David what exactly has taken place. And as he looks at these bloody men, he realizes the efforts that they have gone to for him. But you're not going to believe what happens next. Verse 16, look in your Bible. But David would not drink of it. And he poured it out to the Lord. What? Why would he pour it out? I mean, why wouldn't he take a sip? Why wouldn't he take a drink? I mean, after all, they put their lives on the line. Show a little respect to your best buds, your BFFs here. I mean, they went to a lot of trouble to get, just take one sip of it. Just take one drink of it. Have a little respect for your right-hand men. But you know why David didn't drink it? Because by pouring it out, he was communicating to them that their relationship was more important than the water. The friendship was greater than his thirst. And so David takes the cup and he raises it up and he pours it out on the ground of the cave. And the Bible is clear why he did this. In fact, it explains it and says, he poured it out unto the Lord. Knowing these men had risked their very lives for his sake, he thought that the only person worthy of such sacrifice is the Lord. And so he ceremonially lifts it up and pours it out as a sacrifice to the Lord. And in the very next verse, David emotionally explains his actions to God as he prays to God, and all of these men can hear him. This is what David prays. Verse 17, far be it from me, O Lord, that I should do this. Shall I drink the blood of the men who went at the risk of their lives? And therefore, he would not drink it. These things the three mighty men did. I hope you don't miss the intent of this obscure story of these three unsung heroes. Their respectful faith in the king caused them to take bold steps of faith for the king. And to these three men, this was a life or death commitment when they followed the king. They weren't going to just sit there in their backyards. And neither should you. If you have a respect for your king, your faith should be like these three men, bold, active, intentional. We are actively beating down the gates of hell to bring people into a relationship with Jesus Christ. Here's the mission statement of Harvest Bible Chapel. Harvest Bible Chapel is to glorify God through the fulfillment of the Great Commission. That's the mission statement. To glorify God through the fulfillment of the Great Commission. You know the Great Commission. It's found in Matthew chapter 28, verses 19 and 20. You probably know it. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. That's Jesus speaking. Someone said you could summarize the Great Commission in four words. Go, teach, baptize, teach. Teaching doesn't stop when a person gets baptized. Teaching is a lifelong journey. It's a lifelong learning for us. And so if we learn anything from these mighty men, let us have a passion to please the King. And we do that when we seek to fulfill the Great Commission. When we stop being spiritual couch potatoes and we just don't sit there, but instead we actively and intentionally share our faith and we plant seeds for the gospel in the lives of our neighbors and our coworkers, in the lives of our relatives. You will never reap a harvest at harvest if you never plant a seed. You will never reap a harvest at harvest if you're not out planting seeds. If you truly believe that those who are apart from Jesus Christ have no hope of eternal life, if you truly believe that the Bible is true, and in John chapter 14, verse 6, where Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, no one comes to the Father except through me. If you truly believe that, then we have to share our faith, not just to please the King, but to make an eternal difference in the lives of those who are outside of Christ. I love what Charles Spurgeon said in a sermon back in the late 1800s. This is what he says. He says, if sinners be condemned, at least let them leap to hell over our dead bodies. And if they perish, let them perish with our arms wrapped about their knees, imploring them to stay. If hell must be filled, let it be filled in the teeth of our exertions, and let not one go unwarned and unprayed for. I'm not calling you to be obnoxious Christians. I'm not asking you to be overbearing with others. This is not an encouragement to be holier than thou or to be judgmental. It is a challenge to be passionate about reaching out to others, to intentionally stand up for Christ rather than passively sitting in our lawn chairs. And it's a challenge for us to take up the cross of Christ so that Satan can no longer take more territory and wreak more havoc within families in our region. The church is to be on the offensive, boldly sharing the truth, living a life of joy, of freedom, instead of cowering in a corner and saying, well, nobody wants to know what my spiritual views are. I'm just going to keep them to myself. Rather than allowing Satan to enlarge his territory, it's time that the church began to beat down the walls of hell, the gates of hell, and take back what Satan has illegitimately claimed. We are imitating the passion of David's mighty men in their efforts to defy the enemies of God in order to please the king. And our respectful faith in our perfect king inspires us to take bold risks and to have strong commitments regardless of the cost. You remember what King Jesus said in John chapter 15, verse 13? Greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. And of course, just a few hours after he said those words, Jesus would lay down his own life for his friends and his enemies. And when David was given the cup of water from the Bethlehem well, he poured it out to the Lord. And when Jesus went to the cross and shed his blood for us, he didn't spill his blood for us. He poured out his blood for us. When you spill your coffee or you spill your water in your workplace, it's an accident. No one intentionally spills. When Jesus went to the cross, he intentionally poured out his blood by his choice on our behalf. It was on purpose. He didn't spill his blood. Jesus was very clear about that when he stood before the governor, Pontius Pilate. All he had to do was speak up for himself. All he had to do was say anything in his defense, and his life would have been spared. But instead, Jesus made it clear to Pilate that Pilate wasn't taking his life. Rather, Jesus was giving his life. He says to Pilate, you would have no power over me if it were not given to you from above. His blood being poured out on a cross was no accident. That was the plan before the foundation of the world was ever laid. And Jesus was not spilling his blood. He was pouring out his blood. And with every drop, he was purchasing your forgiveness and he was purchasing my forgiveness. And the night before his crucifixion, Jesus instituted an ongoing memorial to remember the love that he would display at the cross. We call it the Lord's Supper or communion. He told his faithful followers that a piece of bread represented his body. And then he raised up a cup and he told them to drink this fruit of the vine. And he says in Matthew 26, 28, and I want you to fill this in. This is what he says. He says, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. Isn't it interesting that just like King David, our King, Jesus Christ, would raise up a cup, and that he too would compare the contents with blood. But unlike David, Jesus didn't empty the contents of it. He would personally do that the very next day when, as Philippians chapter 2 so eloquently tells us, he emptied himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. And it would be there at Calvary where his blood would freely flow. It's fitting that we would take communion at all of our campuses right now. The world drinks to forget. The Christian at communion drinks to remember, to recall how Jesus was very different from every other king. You see, most kings ask their subjects to lay down their lives for the king, but not our king. Our king laid down his life for his subjects. And so I'm going to invite all the servers at each of our campuses, if you would just come right now at every campus, come to the front. I'm going to pray. And after I pray, they're going to pass out these simple elements, a piece of bread and a cup of juice. And when it comes by after our prayer, I just want you to hold on to that for a minute and to pray and to worship. The bread represents Christ's body. The juice represents his blood. The Lord's Supper and communion is open to anyone who has made Jesus the King and the master of their life. So I'm going to pray, and then the servers at every campus will pass communion out while we worship. And you just hold on to these emblems while you pray and worship. And then the campus pastor will lead you through as we will all take the Lord's Supper together in unison. Let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, we thank you so much for what you did at the cross. I can't imagine a father allowing his one and only son, who was perfect, to die on behalf of imperfect people, some who just minutes before had driven nails into his hands or spat in his face or shouted taunts at him. We thank you today that Jesus died for his friends and he died for his enemies. And may our respect for our leader cause us to take bold steps of faith, to get out of our chairs in our backyard and to move to the front lines. We thank you, Jesus, for your love. It's in the powerful name of Christ that we pray. Amen.